Hey, Calvary Chapel, Santa Barbara Church family, we're making our way through Paul's amazing letter to the Galatians. We're almost finished. I'm going to take it from Galatians chapter 6, verses 11 through 15. And Pastor Sonny's going to finish up the very final few verses of Paul's letter to the Galatians. But let's start at verse 11 and consider what he says starting there. First of all, he says verse 11, kind of a strange verse. He says, "See with what large letters I have written to you with my own hand." Now, notice, it seems that Paul wrote verse 11 with his own hand. He took out a pen or a pencil or whatever it was they were writing with, some kind of quill dipped in ink, whatever it was, and he wrote with his own hand. Now, Paul's custom, typical in the ancient world, was to dictate his letters to a secretary. But he would often, at the very end, write a short portion, both to authenticate the letter and then to add a personal touch. And here, starting at verse 11, is Paul's personal touch written in his own hand. But he makes this remark here in verse 11. It's kind of curious. "See with what large letters I've written." Apparently pointed out, Paul's drawing attention to the fact that when he wrote his postscript with large letters, he did it with big letters. Now, many people speculate that this was because he had poor eyesight and could not read or write small print. But it's just as likely, or maybe more likely, that he just made the letters big simply for emphasis. Paul's saying, "I want you to know that it's me writing, not my secretary, not the person to whom I'm dictating the letter." So this is what Paul wrote with his own hand. And that kind of gets us on the edge of our seat when we take a look here at verse 12. He wrote this with his very own hand, not dictating it to a secretary. Verses 12 and 13, he said this: "As many as desire to make a good showing in the flesh, these would compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For not even those who are circumcised keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised, that they may boast in your flesh." When Paul took out his pen or quill, whatever it was, at the very end of the letter, and wrote with his own hands, he's summing up some of the big themes of the letter. And he's referring to the legalistic Christians among the Galatians. And he wrote very honestly about their motive. Their motive was to make a good showing in the flesh. They wanted to boast in the flesh, as he says there in verse 13. They worked to bring the Galatian Christians from a Gentile background under the law of Moses, under the custom of circumcision, because it would be a good showing for them, a good showing in the flesh. Those legalists pretended to be motivated out of concern for the ones they tried to bring under the law. But Paul saw through that deception and he said, "Your motive is really selfish. You want the honor and the glory of a good showing in the flesh." They wanted the Galatians to become circumcised so that they could wear the submission of these Gentiles as a badge of achievement. And by the way, I want to point something out here. Did you notice that word there in verse 12 where he says, "those who would compel you to be circumcised"? That's an important word. There was nothing wrong with a Gentile being circumcised. There was everything wrong with compelling a Gentile to be circumcised, saying, "You can't be right with God until you come under the law of Moses." Then he says here in verse 12 again, verse 12, "only that they may not suffer persecution for the cause of Christ." Their motive beyond their own glory was to avoid persecution for the cross of Christ. It's as if these legalists in Galatia said something like this. They said, "Listen, we're saved only by the work of the cross of Christ, not by our obedience under the law." If they had said that, they would have been persecuted. And probably the persecution would have come from other legalistic Christians or from those who were still in Judaism. But their unwillingness to stand and align themselves with the cross of Jesus alone, that made them likely to stand for false doctrines. Now, he wrote about the motives of those troubling people among the churches of Galatia in verses 12 and 13. Now in verses 14 and 15, he's going to talk about his motives. Are you on the edge of your seat for this? Here's Paul talking about his motive for ministry. But God forbid that I should glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything but a new creation. Paul's heart cared nothing for the glory that might come from his own fame. He cared nothing for the glory that might come from being wealthy in this world. He cared nothing for the glory that would come from status and power among men. Paul only cared about the glory of the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, brothers and sisters, it's hard for us to appreciate how strange Paul's words were in the ears of someone in the first century. For people who knew what crucifixion was all about, the word cross or crucifixion and glory, those two words did not go together. They were direct opposites because there was not a more humiliating and shameful way to be executed than the cross. It seemed much more logical to glory in your good showing in the flesh instead of the cross. But Paul thought and wrote from a heavenly logic. And he said, no, when it comes to the cross, did you see that? By whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Now, back in chapter 5, Paul wrote about being crucified with the flesh, with its passions and desires. Here, he considers himself dead to the world. The world can no longer have influence over me if I'm a dead man. And Paul couldn't respond to influence from it if he was dead to the world. You know, so it's like this. Paul and the world could agree together on one thing. They didn't like each other. The world's crucified to me, Paul says. And I'm crucified to the world. We don't get along very well, but I get along just fine with Jesus Christ. Don't you love how he ends it here in verse 15? For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything but a new creation. Now, the Galatian Christians had a moral standard to live by. Paul already spoke about that. But what really mattered is not the list of rules that we keep, especially in ceremonies and rituals. What really matters is what God has done for us. Brothers and sisters, let's leave on that point. When Paul says, for in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything but a new creation, it reminds us of this essential point of Christianity. What Christianity is at its core, at its center is, it's not what I do for God. Christianity is what God has done in me. I hope you know that. I hope you cling onto that with all of your heart. It is what God has made us, a new creation. Let me give you a very practical application for this. Why don't you just take a few moments and meditate on that thought that the core, the center, the real purpose of our Christian life is not what we do for God. Now, there's a place for what we do for God. Absolutely. We're not trying to say there's no place for that in the Christian life. There is a place for it. But at its core, Christianity is about the new creation that God has done in me and I didn't do for myself. I hope that becomes the center of the Christian life for you. I hope you get off that treadmill of trying to please God by keeping a list of rules, and instead you live for Him with joy and glory as the new creation that He's made you. God bless you. Apply that. And let's look now for Pastor Sonny to continue and to finish up Paul's letter to the Galatians for us.